you don't know what path you could get led on if one thing was different. Nick was a very important part of my development to get to that level. I'm Luke Lamude, teaching BJJ probably for 10 or 11 years at least. I got into MMA probably in my early 20s for a friend, Spencer Hewitt. He actually runs an academy in Raynham. And he started getting into MMA himself, and then he started making getting a really good success, and I was like, wow, this is impressive. He's come a long way, and he started building up his own team and academy, and probably seeing him start from nothing and going to something made me want to do that as well. I injured my shoulder really badly, ended up having a surgery, and I had to take a long time out from actually training MMA. Tore the labrum in my shoulder, so I took a step down from doing wrestling and striking, but I could still do BJJ because to a degree, because my technical level was good enough that I could sort of hold my own with most people. I could fight with one hand, or I could go with certain people and control it where I weren't injuring my shoulder. I started my own little thing, started a class once a week in a sweaty boxing ring. Sometimes it'd just be two or three of us just rolling around in this boxing ring with dry blood stains on it, but we didn't care because that's all we had to work with. And then I started growing the classes more and more and more. So I started doing two times a week, and then three times a week, and then we went from a decrepit boxing ring to a actual studio upstairs, and I bought some jigsaw mats, and then we went from three or four people to having 10 or 12 people train regularly. Slowly I just kind of went from fighting to teaching more and more and more. I went to a place called Rip Gym that was a bodybuilding gym, and they had a fight studio at the time that they wanted to fill. I got in there and said can I rent the space and blah blah blah, and I moved it to there and grew it further and further. And then we was there for a couple of years, and then we grew from Rip Gym. I eventually decided to get my own premises and grew that gym basically. And it was good at first, but that big step up for me, it was very, very hard, because the bigger your gym gets, you have to have more classes, and you're not just teaching, you're managing a facility and you're managing other people. It's a business, it's a full-on business basically. And it did work, I did make it work, but when COVID hit, it really knocked it for six. And I think that at the time, my enthusiasm and passion was quite low, because the business side really drained me. So I actually downsized to a smaller gym in Bolton, where we are currently. I really like this balance we have now. So we have a smaller gym, but it's not so hard to run. I teach all the classes. It's a nice group of people that come and train. I kind of know everyone. I kind of know all their personalities and their style.
That's bitter. That's bitterer.
It's kind of when I first started training, what I remembered the BJJ was, that it was like a group of mates training together was great. I don't know, there's not many things where you're both squashing each other and choking each other and bending each other's limbs the wrong direction. You're laughing and shaking hands and thanking each other. Oh, thanks for that role. You've just smashed me up. There's not many things like environments you get that kind of vibe. That's where I am now. And yeah, that's my backstory basically of the academy. When I first started training, I trained under a guy called Marc Walder, who was, at the time, he was blue belt. I think maybe blue belt free stripe, actually. And in today's standards, it doesn't sound like nothing, right? If you started academy at blue belt, you'd probably be laughed at and witch hunted on forums and stuff, maybe. But back then, that was like cutting edge. It really was. So yeah, I started training with him, obviously from white belt to brown belt. And Marc had them solid fundamentals and basics, and I mean, like, it was the old school style of jiu-jitsu of like close guard and like a lot of fundamentals and basics, and I think that's where I kind of like cut my teeth, like got my a lot of my basics from. Marc kind of took a step back from teaching, so I kind of for a period of time I was almost, you know, I guess Ronin. I guess I had no coach. I was brown belt with no coach. So then I was doing MMA with, like I said, Spencer. He said, like, you know, you should look to, you know, visit Nick. Nick's a really good guy. You know, he's got a full-time academy. He's doing really well. He's got some really good guys. And I made the trip down there, and that's how I got to Nick.
Hi, my name's Nick Brooks. Academy's been running now for about 9 months. See, so many people's lives change for the better because of training this combat sport. You get people from all walks of life, you know, from all backgrounds.
And I'd seen him, but I didn't quite know him. But, I mean, I always see him at comps. He was always there. You always see him at comps. And he's just like, who is that guy? He's like at every comp, like fighting, just tough as anything. And, I mean, I come to his academy and it was really good training. And I started training with him, and obviously I was like, you know, like, you go, like, how much is it? And I wanted to pay for the session. And he wouldn't even take my money. He just outright refused. I learned a lot. And I feel like from that brown belt, I learned a lot of things that definitely helped me reach black belt. I trained with Nick for like maybe two years. And I wasn't expecting anything. And Nick, you know, he said, like, you know, who you're training under? I said, like, I'm training under no one. But I'll train under you. Like, I definitely want to train under you. That's why I keep coming here. And he was like, oh, okay. Like, I just wanted to, you know, clarify. And I was like, yeah, like, that's why I keep coming here, because I want to train here. And then eventually they had a grading day. I didn't really expect anything. And another friend, Alan Whitten, was kind of pestering me, like, yeah, you got to come. And then we went there, and then that day, that's how I got my black belt. Roger awarded it, obviously, through Nick's recommendation, because I trained under Nick, so he's my coach. Yeah, first one of the, I think me, Chris Hearn, Rob Connor, and I think his name's Deja. Like, one of the first four black belts under Nick was like, that was really big. And me and Nick, like, sort of like, Mark was very much more like philosophical and deep meaning, and Nick was a bit more of like a Jack Sparrow pirate and just like, just go in there and smash him kind of like attitude. And I think It was good to have those two contrasts of like influence, because one's like, yeah, you get the deeper meaning, the other one's like that, like, don't overthink it, just go and biff them and have a good time. So Nick done my first degree, maybe a year before Nick passed. I was meant to get my second, but like he said, I can't remember if he said just put it on, because I was meant to give it to you when he visited me once. And then just before he passed, I was due my next one. Like, he had already wrote the certificate and everything, and like Shelley had just messaged me and said, like, Nick wouldn't want you to have this, you know, it's just, you know, it's just unfortunate that he never got to actually do it. But like, we're just trying to, you know, through what I'm doing now, just trying to carry on what he liked doing, what was teaching and training people, and all the stuff that he gave to people teaching and let me train with his students. So all the bits I've picked up, I'm trying to just give to my guys, and they give to each other, and that's it basically. So yeah, that's Nick was a very important part of my development to get to that level, and have the sort of environment I've got now and some of the contacts I've got now. So yeah.